Good morning, One Church. How are we doing this morning? We are continuing on in our Inspired series. Anybody enjoyed this series so far? We're in part three of this series as our pastor kicked it off. And really the foundation of this, our pastor had a vision for this series in the middle of our summer, giving us an opportunity to really express things that inspired us individually that would then provide an opportunity for us corporately to maybe open up the Word of God and see what it would do and have for us. And so the last couple of weeks, we were exploring the power of the Holy Spirit, its role in our life, and I want to continue to piggyback on that because I believe that God has something really unique in store for us. And so with that, I want to know out there, how many of you have siblings? Anybody out there have siblings? All right, that's most of us. Okay, how many of you are the oldest? Where are my oldest? Okay, where are my youngest at? My people! Yeah, youngest. Where's the middle children? Middle children, you're not forgotten. You're seen and known. I'm just letting it publicly. There it is. Yeah. Uh-huh. All right. My youngest. I'm a youngest-ish. I was a youngest all the way up until freshman of high school. And then we had the privilege of adopting my brother and stuff. So, but I like grew up as a true youngest. And so I have a brother that's 5 years older than I am. And as you can imagine, there's some competition in that old household there. I was a latchkey kid. And so my mom was a single mom, worked two jobs and stuff. So there was like a couple hour gap. And that couple hours was really chaotic for me and my brother. And so with it, I'll never forget. I feel like you older siblings, you have like things that you need to like teach us younger ones. I don't know what you feel like you have to do, but my brother was this way. He would pin me down, he'd hold me down, and then he would start tapping my forehead. He'd say, name 10 candy bars. And I'd be like there panicking and hurting, and then eventually probably crying. And then there's moments when I was at my dad's house, and my dad was in the military, and he had this big military footlocker, and my brother would literally lock me in the footlocker, sit on it, and stuff, and then he would have me say stupid things or whatever. To this day, I'm still claustrophobic. It's fine. But then there was this moment when I was like, all right, I'm getting him back for all the things. I got a blow dart gun. And I was like, oh, here's my moment. Now, mind you, I'm like 10 or 11 years old. And he was sitting there watching TV. And I like, it was just the two of us at home. I already had my escape plan going out the front door. I knew how to run. And so I remember coming around and I pop this dart and it literally lodges into the side of him. And then he yells out. And he starts chasing after me and I got away. Well, I come back a couple hours later while things cool down and I didn't think anything of it. And so I'm on the phone. Now, mind you, this is in the day and age. You remember the corded phones? Anybody remember corded phones? Yes, perfect. All right. Me and all our fourth quarter folk. That's awesome. It's a phone that has a cord to it. Well, we had like the 20-foot cord. You guys know what I'm talking about? Oh, yeah. Katie's with me. Yeah. You can cruise around. You can go to the restroom and cook dinner all while on the phone still. It's perfect. My room had to be next to the kitchen where the phone was at that 20-foot cord, and I was sitting there on the phone, and I don't know who I was talking to. Well, all of a sudden, my brother, he comes gently into my room. I didn't notice it. I'm sitting on my bed. He's got a BB gun. He's retaliating. He shoots me with the BB gun in my leg. I literally start screaming as if I got shot with a real gun. I'm freaking out and losing my mind. And so I'm so mad. Of course, I called my mom. Well, she's a nurse. And I'm like, Mom, you need to come home. Sean shot me. And she thinks the worst, obviously. And eventually came home. And it was just a BB. She goes, seriously? And so still to this day, 23 years later, I still have that BB on the side of my calf. It's right there. Some of you doctors are like, that's probably not healthy. I don't know. It's just there. I kind of forget about it until like I bump against something. But yeah, it's just been there all of these years. I just kind of cruise with it. It's just hanging out. But here's what's so interesting. I say all that because, you know, in life, we do things similarly. Whether we have different things throughout life, we just learn to live with it, don't we? We learn to just bring it on board. This is a part of who I am. This is what I have. This is what I'm going to do. I don't even think about it most days until like one of my girls are like, what is this weird bump on your leg? I'm like, it's a BB. Don't worry about it. It's just an interesting thing that just comes along. Now, here's what I won't never forget this. It was 8 years ago that I was a Christian by this point over a decade. Journey with Jesus for a long time, but I didn't realize there was still more of him that I could have. I didn't realize there's still more healing, still more transformation. I thought, man, I've already experienced so much of Jesus. It's been so great, but there's still more. There are things in my life that I had carried with me my entire life, things that I had yet to let go of, things that I've yet to drop off and experience the transformational work that he wanted to do. But it wasn't until I jumped into a group called Freedom. Freedom is a curriculum that was written by Chris Hodges, as a pastor of Church of the Highlands, and we actually launched these small groups here at One Church just this last year. And so this is what the book is. And when we think about inspired, this is the thing that not only inspired me, but it transformed me. It not only transformed me, but it set me free. And I bring it up because it's in here that I want to begin to journey through a portion of what we navigated through this as really the foundation of this message today. And for those of you that maybe you've yet gone through this, anybody gone through Freedom in the room? All right, some of my folks, yeah, we were in group together. Whew, that was quite the group. And anybody else gone through Freedom? A couple of us. We're actually launching our Freedom groups this fall. And I'll say this, that this little blue book is just packed full of scripture, packed full of truth. And really what it is, it's a roadmap to experience freedom. Freedom from your past, freedom from the things that you're experiencing today to really set you up for the life that God has for you for your tomorrows. And it was in this that 8 years ago, I began to journey through what would be the kind of the unlocking of different areas of freedom in my own life. And so with that, the foundation of our scripture today is this. It's in Proverbs 4. If you have your Bibles, you can turn there. We're just going to briefly read this together. In Proverbs 4, verse 20 through 23, it says this. He says, "My son, pay attention to what I say. Listen closely to my words. Don't let them out of your sight. Keep them within your heart, for they are life." Everybody say life. "To those who find them, and health to a man's whole body. Above all else, guard your heart." Say, guard your heart. "For it is the wellspring of life." Really, in this scripture, it doesn't say block everything from coming into your heart, wall up and not, don't let anything come in. It says guard. Really, in the mix of this, it's an understanding. It's literally taking close attention or pay attention to what it is that you allow in. And really, in the mix of this, I didn't up until this point of navigating through this, I knew that was something I should do, but I didn't realize the amount of damage that things that I've allowed into my world was actually having. And really what I did is I just allowed stuff to come on board into my life and just realize, hey, that's just going to be with me forever. It's just like the BB in the leg. It's like, I'm just going to have this with me always. I'm just assuming this is how I have to figure out how to navigate life. Until everything changed when I encountered truth, and it's a truth of his word. Here's what I recognize is it's not meant for us to wall off and not allow anybody in or anything in. That's pretty unhealthy. But it's saying, hey, we're standing guard. That there is something that God wants to do in and through us, and that may we continue to stand guard, stand post as to what we allow close into the inner courts of who we are. This kind of led me to this point where a couple years ago, gosh, it's going to be 5 years ago coming this Thursday, our third born, Remy, it's her birthday this Thursday. But when my wife was pregnant with Remy, she was the problem child out of all four of my sweet wife's pregnancies. And my mom is laughing up here because it scared all of us. In the mix of this pregnancy, my wife had a ton of different symptoms. And she would have, you know, obviously your normal weariness and tiredness, but it's pretty severe. And so what they would do is they were trying to medicate all of her symptoms. So she got iron supplements and different things and IVs. And then she started getting dizziness and they're not sure why. And then numbness in her left arm. And then her blood pressure was crazy. So they're giving her a children's Advil every day. A ton of different visits. All of these different things kind of led to this point where she had to get a heart monitor. So they put these electrodes around her heart to kind of manage what was going on because they're watching that there was some misfiring with the electrodes that are going on in her heart. I don't know what any of that means, but all I know is she wore this really fun necklace that then transmitted all this information back to Florida to let us know when she had what we called an episode, it would start to measure what was taking place in her heart. Well, for the course of months, we were trying to help figure out all the symptoms, but until we realized what was taking place is the duress of the baby upon her body was causing the lower ventricles of her heart to kind of have this misfiring effect, which is causing weariness, dizziness, and a litany of other things throughout her body. The solution to all of this was get that baby out of you. And so once she did, she was back to normal and all was great. But what's interesting in the mix of that is that we were constantly dealing with all of the symptoms, not knowing how to deal with the actual root. It's the same thing when you have a cold. We're not really in cold and flu season, but when you do, what we do sometimes is you have a cold and you got the cough and it's a bummer. What do? You pop a few cough drops. Well, those cough drops don't heal you from the sickness. They begin to alleviate the symptoms. The same is true as oftentimes as we're navigating through life is that we're constantly trying to take things to alleviate the symptoms without actually going to the root to experience the true freedom and healing of what God wants to do in your life and in my life. I didn't know this that for over a decade, I was carrying some things with me that I didn't have to carry any longer. Hardships, difficulties, mindsets, confusions, things that coexisted in my life that I didn't know that God wanted to come in and was ready to transform all of it. It wasn't until I walked through and navigated this and had scripture illuminate to me the truth that I began to experience this freedom. Today, what I want to do is the title of this message is really the blockages of the heart. There are two blockages that I want to navigate with you that really were my blockages. They may be things that you resonate with and they may not be, but they're just two things, and there's a litany of other blockages of our heart, if you can go along with the analogy, that some of us will experience. If anyone's known of somebody that's had a heart attack, what happens? It's the arteries that they get clogged, the blood flow that carries life to the rest of your body and then back to the heart. When those get constricted, what does it do? It begins to cause a litany of symptoms. It starts to cause the other things of your body to start to shut down and ultimately can lead to the end of life. But here's what we are wanting to talk about. It's the same way even with our heart. When you talk metaphorically in the concept of our life, that there are things in us that God wants to begin to start to remove some blockages, allow new life to flow, that there be a freedom to come forth. And I read recently, as the author said this, he says, anything we decide to hold on to becomes our responsibility to maintain. Anything we decide to hold on to becomes our responsibility to maintain. And I didn't realize this, but there was a lot of things that I was holding on to that I was also trying to maintain. And it was at this point when I came to this realization that I didn't have to hold on to this any longer, but that God wanted to step in and begin to bring about freedom in the mix of my own pain and allow there to be a complete freedom in that blockage of my own heart. Here's what I see here as we look at these two blockages. The first one is this. It's bitterness. Bitterness. Bitterness was a blockage that I carried throughout most of my life, and I just assumed this is what everybody had to deal with. There is going to be somebody that will offend you at some time, at some moment, and then there's this bitterness that rises up, and it's just part of how we coexist in life. But isn't it interesting how there are mean people that will say mean things, and they kind of just roll off our backs? And then there's moments when there's mean people that say mean things, and then it sticks. Not only does it stick, it starts to bring a definition to who we are, what we'll be about, what we do and don't do. And oftentimes, those individuals that speak those words are those that typically are close to us. And oftentimes, it's often the individual that is usually our father. I'm not dogging on dads today, as I'm trying to be a good dad myself, but the realization in this room is many of us have been hurt by those that are very close to us. Bitterness has found its way into many of our lives. It comes into this place and begins to develop a root. And out of that root, there's a litany of other symptoms that will emerge. And what we do is we can close off, wall off, isolate. We begin to experience even depression and darkness. We start to try to medicate and deal with the symptoms and never actually go to the root. But today, what I want to do is just talk about the root of how do we actually begin to experience complete freedom from this area of what we call bitterness. You know, it's interesting because I think for us is the moment that I say that for us to experience forgiveness, We oftentimes will think of this like, gosh, that they deserve my anger and frustration towards them. If you only knew what that other person did. Have you ever been there before? It's like you play in that like whole monologue in your head. You're like, oh, if I ever get a chance to talk to them, these are all the things that I would say. Have you been there before? Oh yeah, you've been talking about to your boss by yourself in the shower, and you're thinking of all the things you're gonna say to that boss. Like, oh yeah, we've all been there. But here's what happens. You know, I heard an author say this recently as well. They said that unforgiveness, it's like lighting yourself on fire, hoping that they will die from smoke inhalation. Graphic, I know, I get it. Welcome to Sunday morning. But it's a visual of the realization of what unforgiveness does in you. You sit there and you think about withholding your love, withholding your affection, withholding from somebody else, even a relationship, and you think like, oh, I'm damaging them. They deserve this. All the while, you're the one that's suffering. All the while, you're the one that's decaying, and all the while, you're carrying around the BB in the leg of bitterness that just coexists in your world, and it's just now a part of you. And you are now having symptoms of the root of bitterness, and you're trying to deal with the symptoms instead of actually going to the root. Here's what I say in the mix of this is I've done a ton of work in the area of forgiveness, and I still probably have more to do. But as I navigated in this, forgiveness does not mean reconciliation. Reconciliation can only happen when there's three ingredients in there. The first ingredients for reconciliation, meaning coming back together to restore one's relationship again. When there has been a cause of abuse or harm or a breaking, for there to have this ick that's there, to have this forgiveness to be extended, there's got to be three things. The first, there's got to be an element of repentance. Then it moves into this restitution to restore, that meaning that, man, they take ownership for what takes place with a willingness to begin to restore, which leads to the third one is a rebuilding of trust. Without these three ingredients from both parties to agree to move together, there can never be this point of restoring of a relationship. But what you can do is you forgive, is you're taking back the power that the other individual held over you. Whether or not that they're able to come to a point or you're able to come to a point of restoring, because there are some things that are so egregious that you will never need to actually be restored. You just need to release. Hear me on this, because this is where I got confused. Because what I began to believe is that when I forgave somebody, I was stamping the approval of what they did to me. I was beginning to say, oh, all of the years of the things that you did are finally okay and I'm able to move on. Nope. What it means is that none of it was okay. I was never all right with it. But guess what? You no longer get to hold the power of what you did over me any longer. I'm taking it back. I release you and I forgive you and I'm moving on with my life. The BB's getting out of the leg, everybody. But that's what we do, is we start to attack the root. It's interesting how the enemy is so cunning in this area, and I found this to be true in my own life, because what he does is the enemy oftentimes uses these snares to entrap us in unforgiveness when we are betrayed, falsely accused, rejected, abused, and humiliated. When we experience these different things, what happens is that we can get entrapped in it. And then what happens even further is that what the words or the actions that have taken place have now incarcerated us, and we no longer are able to move forward in life, that now we are stunted in where we are. But here's the kindness of our Heavenly Father. Really, the inspiration that came forth was when I started to navigate this in this little book, is when God began to open up my eyes to the fact that I can now be completely freed. That I can be completely whole, healed, and restored. That I can be renewed. The Bible declares, even for us, in Ephesians 4:32, it says, be kind and compassionate to one another, forgiving each other, just as in Christ God forgave you. Man, that ain't easy. But he's declaring it for us. It leads us into the point where Mark says in 11:25, it says, and when you stand praying, if you hold anything against anyone, forgive them, so that your Father in heaven may forgive you of your sins. Really what this is that God recognizes that the root of bitterness has a way of plaguing our minds and our life that can hold us and stunt us from all that he has in store for us. If you can think of it in an imagery like this, so I've got this duffel bag up here. And so I'm not talking about, like, you know, the weight of sin in our life and we got to lug it around. No. If I can give you the imagery of this, is that if life was this duffel bag and we were all given the same size duffel bag and in here it had the same capacity. Here's the thing, if you can just imagine with me, is that you can't just trade in to get a larger duffel bag to start to shove aside bitterness and unforgiveness. You just get one bag. And in this bag, if you choose to hold on to this bitterness, what it does is it takes up space and place. So when God wants to come in and start to fill you with more, some of us are praying for joy. Some of us are praying for peace and asking God for these things. But yet what happens is when the bag is full of bitterness and this abuse and anger, what it does is it starts to take up space where he isn't able to fill. But when he declares in his word that may we start to forgive and let go, what it does is it starts to release and it allows there to be more space for some other things. So once we get some of this stuff out of there, what does this do? Man, I got some capacity for more. But yet we're only given one bag. And I wonder today, is in your bag, is there room for more of what the Holy Spirit wants to do in you? Or do you need to offload some things to allow there to be space before he can start depositing in? Because I think for some of us, just like I was, over a decade, I was at the time maybe 8 or 9 years married, and I thought life was really good, but I did not know there's more. I just thought I had to lug around with me. These are just the parts of life that are really hard, really dark, and this is just how it's going to be. But God said, no, I've meant for you to walk in wholeness. I've meant for you to walk restored and renewed. I've meant for you to no longer have a cloud of shame, condemnation over your life, but that you are meant to live in the fullness of what I have. If truly what the cross represents, that we can walk in the fullness of Christ, then we've got to recognize there's more that he's wanting to do in your life, in my life, that we got to step into the promises of what God has for us and the hope that is there, that he would continue to restore and renew, but we got to go to the roots and stop just dealing with the symptoms. Which leads to the second thing that was a blockage of the heart. And in this one, this was rejection. Rejection is this thing that, it's a bummer. And here's the reality is that I recognize that throughout life that there will be things and moments where you'll experience rejection, even from some that are closest to you, a spouse, family members, that it's a protection mechanism oftentimes in this place of just beginning to push everyone out to try to protect the heart because you are already so broken and so fragile that you can't handle another hurt and another pain. We wall off, we isolate, and we go inward. And what it is that we are suffering alone. And we're constantly in darkness, and then we just coexist and we walk through the doors of this church and we put on a smile and people ask, how are you? And we're, oh, great. All the while you're thinking to yourself, if anyone actually knew the darkness that I'm experiencing. And for those that are tuning in online and in this room today, I just want to remind you that you have a God in heaven that loves you so much. Not only does he love you, is he's wanting to come into your space and place and begin to remove that darkness because it's never what he intended for you. It's the causality of what sin has then stepped into our world and has caused this brokenness. Now what we need is the renewal of not only of our mind, but of the power of the Holy Spirit to break off some of these areas. You know, it was about 7 or 8 years ago that my mother-in-law is sitting here today, and I love my mother-in-law. I got blessed. Some of y'all are like, dude, my mother-in-law's crazy. I got blessed with this one, not just because she's in the room, but she truly is a gift into our world. And so it was 7 or 8 years ago, we lived in Puyallup, and my mom was pastoring down in Vancouver, and every Thursday she would drive up 3 hours, and she would take care of our two girls. At the time, we only had the two. And for, 2 years, Mama, you did this? And so she was there because Christina and I, my wife and I, we worked and we both worked full time. And so she helped kind of bridge the gap for us. Well, on this particular Thursday, she came up and she was getting ready for bed and she was going to take a bath and doing her thing. And there was an update on Facebook. Now, there's a brand new update that happened, and this was the thing called Facebook Live. I don't remember if you remember or recall when this first came out. It's kind of a brand new feature. Well, my mama didn't know that this was a new feature that happened as she's getting ready for the bath, that she accidentally pressed Facebook Live. So as you can imagine, she's been pastoring at this point over 40 years, has tons of people that are following her and is leading a congregation herself. So they can, you can just imagine, oh, Pastor Grace, it's going on Facebook Live. I wonder what richness she's going to provide for us today. Little did they know, they got a little more than they bargained for. It wasn't until my sister-in-law saw what was taking place, calls my mama up, and she says, Mom, you got to turn off your Facebook. You're broadcasting all that you're doing right now. She goes, oh, dear Jesus. And she puts out a little post after it. She goes, to those of you that joined my Facebook Live, dear Jesus, so sorry. Well, coming this fall, my mother-in-law is going to be launching a small group. It's called Bible and Bubbles on Thursday night. It's a women's only group, everybody. True story, mama. Now she knows what Facebook Live is. But here's the deal. Like, have you ever been in an embarrassing moment before? Like, maybe not that embarrassing, but like, we've had those moments where you're like, I could just crawl in a hole right now. Like, I could just disappear, and I'd be totally fine with that. Like, I wish no one actually knew. I would love to hit the rewind button and redo this. But as you kind of turn the page and you realize, like, there are some areas in our life that, gosh, we want to just hide. We would love to just cower back, and we would love to try to hit the, like, reset button on. And we wish that we didn't do those things or experience those things. And yet here we are. And oftentimes in this place of rejection, we're living with this immense pain that what we do is that we just live as a place and a person that is rejected. So we just stop trying altogether. We view ourselves through the lens of rejection. And so we don't apply for the job. Rejection is so real for many of us is that we stay in singleness because we don't think that we'll ever be loved. I'm not dogging people today. What I'm wanting to do is I'm wanting to then begin to expose the lie that has emerged because the accuser that has come forth in your world has held you back for far too long. You are greater than you think you are. You have more to offer than you realize. And God is wanting to help you step out of this place of rejection into a place of promise. There's a hope today that we have that when we begin to start to experience faith is to believe that this is possible. Hope is to believe that it is possible for me. And it is possible for you. And I know for myself, as I was navigating through this curriculum, and it was in here that I started to begin to have hope, and not only hope, that I started to experience transformation, where the power of rejection no longer had its talons in my life, but God started to step in and restore the identity of who I was in Him. It's the same thing He wants to do in you. So we ask this big question as we go through these blockages of the heart. How do we do this? Where do we even turn from here? Well, I wanted to continue to piggyback off of what Pastor was talking about last week, because I believe this, that there's three steps to transforming that heart, to begin to start to open that thing up, not only just forgiveness, but also I believe this, that God wants to come into your space and place and begin to help you experience the fullness of what He has. And the first thing that we've got to do, and it's a responsibility on our part, is that we invite the Holy Spirit to show me. Just show me. Show me what it is that's in this bag that does not belong. Show me that what I'm carrying around that I know that I don't need to be carrying around. Because what it does is He starts to illuminate the things that need to go, and He helps you become ready. Because I don't know about you, but I know for me, my bitterness became a friend. It became something that I would hold on to because it felt that I was being justified for all the egregious things that have taken place. And what I did is I held on to it, and I didn't realize that that was the thing that was actually starting to destroy and erode and hold me back from really what God had. And as the Holy Spirit started to illuminate it, what He did is He just gently came in, and when I was ready, and I happened to be sitting with a counselor, and he just started to navigate me through this forgiveness process. And I took back the power from the individuals that have taken things from me. I love what Ezekiel says, because in Ezekiel 36, it declares this in verse 26. He says, I will give you a new heart and put a new spirit in you. I will remove from your heart of stone and give you a heart of flesh. And I will put my spirit in you and move you to follow my decrees and be careful to keep my laws. He says, I'll put a new spirit in you. There's a heart transplant that is happening. That original word, it's the pneuma. It's the breath of God or the presence of God. He says, I'm going to place this inside of you. You are not weak and feeble. You are not broken and too far gone. Let me remind you of the God that you serve. And if you allow him to come on the inside, there's a transformative work that he wants to do. And there's some things in your bag that you can offload today, or at least start the process, that you don't have to carry around those BBs in your leg. Bitterness does not have to be a friend. Rejection does not have to be the poison that you drink on a consistent basis. But we ask the Holy Spirit, illuminate. And then we go into this next portion. Invite the Holy Spirit to change me. I know it sounds so simple and there's more complexity to it, but as you think of David, he was an individual that was an adulterer and a murderer. And this is what he says in Psalms. As he pens this and he writes this in Psalms 51, 9 through 11, it says, hide your face from my sin and blot out all of my iniquities. Create in me a pure heart, O God, and renew a steadfast spirit within me. Do not cast me from your presence or take your Holy Spirit from me. What David is doing is he's crying out. He says, oh God, may you forget all of the sin and the junk that I did. And here's the beautiful thing is your Heavenly Father does just that. He does not keep a record or a file of all the things you've thought about, all the egregious things you've engaged in, all the stuff that you've looked at. The moment that you actually come and repent and you say, Lord, forgive me. Literally, it's turning from one action and moving a different direction. It says that you are made white as snow. You are a new creation in Christ. It is now blotted out. His love has covered it. He does not hold it over you any longer. You have been set free. So if your sins have been forgiven, then walk as an individual that has been forgiven. Don't walk with a limp thinking that I'm not deserving of something because of what I've engaged in. Oh, you lift your head up high. You get up off of the mat. You stop staying down and you continue to walk into the promises of what God has for you. Men and women, we are called to more. Your kids need you to stand tall and to run after the promises of God over you. There are generations that are following us, need us to continue to pursue the hope that we have in Jesus. May we be a church that steps into the promises of God and recognizing there is more. And now what we're doing is inviting the Holy Spirit in to begin to change. And lastly, as we see, so we invite the Holy Spirit to fill you. In Ephesians, and I know this is going to be a unique scripture, but in Ephesians 5:18, it says this, don't get drunk on wine, which leads to debauchery. Meaning this, don't engage into senseless indulgences. Stop. This world doesn't have what God can offer. It is a consistent thing. Sin will always leave you wanting more, and it will leave you more empty than you were before. And here's the recognition is that stop going after senseless indulgences, but instead be filled with the Spirit. As we start to examine, we ask the Lord, as we have in our life, what is it that you're wanting to take out of my duffel bag? And it's not enough. As I went through this curriculum, really what it does is it leads you all the way to a place of getting rid of some stuff, casting off some stuff, breaking up with some stuff, healing from some things. And it's like you're constantly like dredging out. It's like taking that big old backhoe and you're digging a bunch of stuff out. Now you're left with like a pretty empty, open cavern here, and there's a lot of space. And now we invite the Holy Spirit to fill. Lord, fill me up. After we have released, experienced freedom and healing, now fill me up. And that's exactly what God wants to do in many of your lives today. And you may be at that place where you're just ready for more. You're hungry for more. You're longing for more. For some of you, you might be at this place where it's like, I'm ready to release. I'm ready to take back the power that someone else has held over me. I'm ready to let go of the rejection, the abuse, the darkness that has plagued my world for too long. Wherever you find yourself today, I believe this, that God has something for all of us. So all across this room, if you join me by bowing your heads and closing your eyes, that we're just creating a very public moment to be a private one. And I'm not sure where you find yourself this morning, but I want to give you an opportunity to say yes to Jesus. Maybe you're brand new to church and you're like, whoa, this is a lot, but I feel something. There's like a tug, like a, man, I think I want this relationship. It's as simple as saying yes to him, inviting him to be the Lord of your life, asking him to forgive you of your sins, turning from that and embracing this hope that we have in Jesus. Or maybe you're here this morning, you want to rededicate your life to Christ, or you're joining us online, and we'd love for you to type in and let us know the decision that you're making. But I'm going to invite you on the count of three to raise your hand and say, yes, that's me. And all that's doing is identifying that you want to be included in this prayer and recognizing that this is for you. So on the count of three, if you would, just pop up your hand, and we're going to pray together and invite Jesus to be the Lord of our life. One, two, three, just raise your hand. Raise your hand. Yes, 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 yes. Yeah. Yes. Yes. I love it. Yes. Yeah. Thank you, Lord. All right. Put your hands down. Let us all pray out this prayer together. Can we all say this together? Lord Jesus, thank you for loving me. Wherever I am, please forgive me of my past. Wash me clean. And from this day forward, I'm yours. In Jesus' name, amen and amen. Can we celebrate all those saying yes to Jesus? I love the multi-generations of people that are saying yes to him. It's such a beautiful picture of what the church is about. And as we close out our time together, I want to do this. I invite you, if you would, stand to your feet. We've got our prayer team that's going to be coming to my right and to my left. And they're really here as individuals just to stand alongside of you. Mama, I would love for you to step out too. I think that there are some women that are meant to go to my mama today. And she's been a pastor for many years and has immense wisdom. But here's what I believe. Some of you needing to be filled up, and that's what you want prayer for. So I just need to be filled up. There's spaces and places. Like, I've done some dredging. I've done some work, but I want to be filled up. And then there's some of you that are ready to start to let some stuff out of your bag to create some more space. These individuals are here to pray with you, and I just want to pray over you. And for those of you that said yes to Jesus, man, we are so excited for you that you don't want to make the best decision of your life and just let it stop right there. It's like hitting a home run and then never running the bases. Like, we want to help you run the base. And the first base is this, is that you can just click that QR code in the seat back in front of you. Let us know the decision that you made today. Swing on by our Connect booth out in the lobby. We've got a Bible and a book that our pastor wrote that we'd love to get in your hands and help you with your next steps as well. With that being said, let me pray for you. Father, I just thank you for every individual in this room and those that are online with us today. I thank you for the hope that we have in you, but more than that, for the work that you're wanting to do in many of our lives. Freedom is accessible to many today. And more than that, that there is now even a filling of your Holy Spirit that you're wanting to deposit in many of our lives as well. I thank you for the work that you've done, but also what you're going to continue to do. In the mighty name of Jesus, we all said amen and amen. Hey, church, thank you so much for joining us today. Feel free to stand with one of our prayer team members. Have a blessed week. We'll see you next Sunday.
We are so glad you spent the day with us. If you made that decision today to say yes to Jesus, we just want to say welcome home. You made the best decision you will ever make.
Be sure to scan the QR code on your screen and let us know. We have a free gift for you. Pastor Will wrote a book titled You Matter to God, and you can download the book today as you take your next step.
Yes, and if you need prayer today, you can click the button on your app or on your screen right now. Throughout the week, you can also go to our website and request prayer there as well.
Yes, thank you guys for joining us. See you next week.